Yeah, actually, I'm going to start with a history about Sweden and the economic history about Sweden. It was actually in the end of the 1980s, the Swedish bank sector was deregulated. And after that, it had occurred a sort of catastrophe. It was bank crisis. At the same time, we tried to link the Swedish crown to the European currency unit, ECU. And that lasted for a little bit more than 1 year. During that time, the Central Bank of Sweden, they tried to defend the rate pegged to the ECU with putting up the interest rate up to 500% maximum. During that time, it was put the private persons into big crisis, and some of them they had to left their homes because it was too high interest rates.
Aštuņus gadus, kad Zviedrijas banku sistēma tika atbrīvota no dažādām regulācijām, tur notika vairāk, teiksim, banku bankrotu, un arī notika mēģinājums, kas gan ilga tikai vienu gadu, piesaistīt Zviedrijas kronu pie Eiro priešteču ECU, tas bija tāds, nu, teiksim, arī maksāšanas līdzeklis Eiropas Savienībā. Un pēc tam Centrālā banka mēģināja noturēt apmaiņas kursu, ieguldīja ļoti lielu naudu un paaugstināja procentu likmes, kas vienā brīdī sasniedz par 500% gadā. Un šī likme, lai noturētu attiecīgi apmaiņas kursu, tas izraisa arī privāta persona bankrots un dažādas problēmas, un pēc tam no šīs sistēmas atteicās.
And some say that it takes maybe less than 1 year to ruin your reputation for your economy in the world market, but it takes 25 years to rebuild it. And for sure, it's true. It's now we can see that we are back on track again.
Paldies, ka šis viens gads diezgan stipri sagrāva Zviedrijas ekonomiskā reputācija pasaules, nu teiksim, tirgu. Un pēc tam bija vajadzīgi faktiski 25 gadā atjaunot šo reputāciju. Tagad var teikt, ka jau Zviedrija ir atgriezusies tādā labā līmenī.
And during that time, what happened? We had we had an agreement later between the Social Democratic Party and the Centre Party. The Centre Party is now in the Conservative government, but in that time, it was some crisis agreement made.
Tātad politiskās partijas, ieskatot Centra partiju un Sociāldemokrātus, kas tādā kā bija valdībā, viņi tad panāca noteikti veidu politisko vienošanos par to, kā tiks tālāk šīs jautājums risināts.
Yeah, and the first one was the Swedish crown was floating, so that it was priced by the market every single second, and it's still. And during that time, first the crown went down sharply, and also we had also some kind of budget discipline about the budget must over time have a constant surplus. We can never go on minus.
Un vienošanās pamata elementi jau tādā laikā bija tādi, teiksim, kas arī pašu laikā līdz vienam mērā tas ielabāt, ka tātad, pirmkārt, Zviedrijas valoda netika piesaistīta ne pie kādas citas valodas, vai arī pie valoda groza, bet tās vērtība brīvi noteica tirgus, un sākumā kronas vērtība pazeminājās pēc šā lēmuma pieņemšanas. Un otrs lēmums bija, ka budžetām, valsts budžetām vienmēr jābūt ar plus zīmi, tātad mēs budžeta deficītam, bet kurā gadījumā pozitīva pārpalikuma.
Yeah. During 1 or 2 years you can go and spend more money than you take in, but then you have to earn it back later, some years later.
Faktiski, atbilstot situācijai, var arī 1 vai 2 gadus tomēr pieļaut nulli budžeta deficītu, bet pēc tam tas ir jāatpelna atpakaļ ar pozitīvu budžetu.
And during that period, around in 94, we had a referendum about membership in the European Union, and that was actually a very narrow yes. Sweden voted 52% voted yes for membership in the European Union. And during that campaign also, all political parties on the yes side said that membership in a coming monetary union, that we can decide later.
Un kad 94. Gadā notika iestāšanās referendums par dalību Eiropas Savienībā, kas beidzās ar to, ka ļoti šaura, teiksim, atšķirība 52% vēlētāji nobalsoja par dalību Eiropas Savienībā, 52% faktiski ar 2%. Šajā te kampaņā tika teikts, visas politiskās partijas teica, ka lēmumu par to, vai mēs pievienosimies Eiro zonai, ieviesiesim Eiro, tad šis lēmums tiks pieņemts atsevišķi.
Yeah, and later, when we became member in the European Union in 1995, the discussion about single currency and monetary union got more intense, and around 1999, the 4th of January 1999, the technical euro was a fact. That was the first day of trading of the technical euro. And I must write some figures down, because lots of people think that the floating Swedish crown is going to be very small on the market. Especially the famous Swedish foreign minister Carl Bildt, he said something, it's going to be like some small piece of paper floating out in the sea, it's going to be nothing.
Un tā laikā, kad notika nu, diskusija par to, kas notiks ar Svedijas kronu, kad tā palaidīs brīvā, tas ar brīvā tirgu, nepiesaistot nepie kā, protams, bija daudz, kur uzskatīja, ka šī Svedijas kronas vērtība būs ļoti zema, tajā skaitā arī slavenais sapraudiski slavenais Karls Bildts Zviedrijas ārlietu ministrs, kurš uzskatīja, ka vispār tādā gadījumā Zviedrijas krona būs tāds papīrītis, ko komentās spēcīgs vējš. Tas ir tas viens no argumentiem arī šajās diskusijās. Un tagad būs daži cipari par to, kas notika patiesībā.
So actually, the first day when we had a trade of the euro, it was 9.55 Swedish crowns. It's now 8.2. The US dollar was 8.02. And it's today 6.58 Swedish crowns.
It was on 99.
It was the 1st of January 99.
99. Kad bija pirmā diena, kad parādījās, teiksim, eiro, kad pašā bija tajā laikā bezskaidrā nauda, tas saucamais tehniskais eiro, tad 1 eiro maksāja 9,54 Svedijas kronas un attiecīgi
One euro was 9.54 Swedish krona, now it's 8.2.
Tagad tas ir 8,2, tad Zviedrijas kronas vērtība pret eiro ir pieaugusi, un attiecīgi arī pret amerikāņu dolāru. 99. Gadā tas bija 8,02, un tagad 6,58.
So that's the development of the weak, rubbish currency floating out in the sea. Actually, it's managing quite well on the world market.
Tātad Zviedrijas kronas pasaules tirgu jūtas ļoti labi, un tas nav tas, ka, teiksim, tā būtu kaut kāda tāds maziņš papīrītis, ka mētās viņa un vēšana, un tā.
Yeah, next, then it was a debate about the euro. Lots of people on the yes side says that now it's time for Sweden to join the euro because we are obliged to the, according to the treaty between European Union and Sweden. Of course, it's in the treaty that we must enter the euro, but the politicians said in the referendum that it's a later decision.
Un tālāk, pēc kāda brīža, kad sākās saruna par to, vai Zviedrija pievienosies eiro zonai, tika paziņots, ka iestāšanās līgumā, gluži tāpat kā tas tagad tiek paziņots Latvijā, ir paredzēts, ka Zviedrijai jāpievienojas eiro valūtai, un šī valūta ir jāievieš.
Yeah, actually, later on, in the beginning of the 2001, I think, it was Carl Bildt and the Prime Minister of the Social Democratic Party, Göran Persson, they accepted that it's going to be a referendum sometimes. And in the beginning of 2003, it was official that it's going to be a referendum in September 2003.
Bet tagad tomēr partijas bija solījuši, ka šis lēmums tiks pieņems tā kā atsevišķi, teiksim, 2002. Gadu sāka jau, teiksim, valdošie politiķi, arī Jonas Persons, premjerministrs un Karls Bildts, kopumā piekrīt, ka referendums kaut kad varētu būt, un 2003. Gadā bija skaidrs, ka referendums būs, kas Zviedrija balsos tomēr, neskaties uz to, ka līgumā paredzēts, ka viņiem obligāti ir jāievieš eiro, tāpat kā vēlreiz, kas ir Latvijas līgumā, Zviedrija tomēr nolēma, ka viņi par to nobalsos referendumā.
Yeah, and for sure, people in Brussels, they say that it doesn't matter, you must anyway in the future joining the euro because you are obliged to do it.
Un, protams, ka Briseles atbildē, ka nu jūs jau, protams, tur varat visi ko kaut ko balsot, bet jūs līgumā rakstīs, ka jums ir jāpievienos eiro un jums nākotnē nāksies pievienoties.
But in the morning, September 15, when almost 56% of the Swedish people rejected the euro, 42% said yes. The people in Brussels said that we have to accept the Swedish decision.
Un bija ļoti interesanti pavērot, ka 2003. Gada 14. septembrī, 15. septembrī, dienu pēc šeit referenduma, kā mainījās, teiksim, Briseles attieksme, kad viņi paziņoja, ka, nu jā, protams, mums ir jāakceptē, jā, mums jāakceptē Zviedrijas tautas pieņemtais lēmums.
There I have to tell to you in Latvia, as a friend of Latvia and as taken a lot of time in the beginning of the 90s, and I saw your your struggle for independence, and I saw when you introduced your currency, you got your own passport and everything, that the currency, the national bank are two very, very important tools for a country's independence.
Un kā Latvijas draugs, pie tam Lars šeit ir bijis arī 90. gados, un kā cilvēks, kurš redzējis, kā Latvija atgūst neatkarību, kā atgūst savu valodu, savu pasmu, savu centrālo banku, viņš grib pateikt, ka šie te instrumenti ir ļoti, ļoti svarīgi, tāda kā centrālā banka, kā savu nacionālā valūta, un nevajag tos lat projām.
Yeah, and in the economy you have certain different tools. You have level of unemployment, you have the currency, you have the interest rates, and also the growth in the economy. If it's working between the unemployment, the currency, the exchange rate, and the interest rates, then you get a high and good growth in the economy. If it's not working, it's going to be a bad development for your economy. And if you don't have the tools, the development is going to be bad.
Un tāpēc ekonomika ir tāds, teiksim, nu, līdzekļi, ja, instrumenti, kā, teiksim, nodarbinātība, kā procentu likmes, kā, teiksim, izaugsmes tēmas un tā pārējā, teiksim, šie instrumenti. Un to pareizi, teiksim, proporcija darbojas, tādā gadījumā jūs beigās iegūst, nu, teiksim, attīstību izaugsmu, to, ko jūs vēlaties, bet, ja, teiksim, jums šo instrumentu nav, vai arī šo instrumentu darbojas. Tā kā, teiksim, viņam vajadzētu, tad, protams, ka šī rezultāta ekonomikā nav sevišķi iepriecinoši, man ir izskoties.
Yeah, and during that time, I can also say that the Prime Minister of Sweden in that time, the Social Democratic Göran Persson, he said, like Lava said before, that the voters in Sweden, they were threatened by, if you don't say yes to the euro, you're going to pay between 90 and 100 lat a month more for your house, because the interest rate in Sweden is going to be higher than in the eurozone. Now it's actually lower. You have to pay less interest rate if you have the crown rate instead of the euro.
Un tāpat kā Dānijā, protams, arī šeit kampaņā vēlētāji tika piedraudēts. Toreiz Zviedrijas premjerministrs paziņoja, ka jūs katrs no mums jūs maksāsiet no 90 līdz 100 latiem, ja mēs pārējām Latvijas vairāk mēnesī, ja vien Zviedrija nepievienosies eiro, jo tad procenti būs augstāki. Un patiesībā izrādījās tieši otrādi, pašlaik Zviedrijā procentu likmes par kredītiem ir zemāks nekā eiro zonā.
And now I actually must make some explanation about why the euro is not working and why the euro is not going to work if the euro countries.
Tātad es gribētu pateikt nekārši dažs pamatojumi, kāpēc eiro kā valoda nedarbojas un kāpēc šī valoda arī nedarbosies nākotnē.
If the euro countries are not going to change, they have to choose. Otherwise you are living like you did before, then you must have your own currency. And as you can see, this is a summary about some important countries, how they have lived during the period from the 4th of January 1999 until now. This is first. Actually, first, this is Japan. From the prices since 1999, more than 13 years, has gone down with 4.1% during that long time. But the prices in Sweden has risen with 21.5% during.
Cenas ir pieaugušas 21.5% šajā laikā.
And in Germany 24.5%. So you can see still countries outside the euro, we have lower inflation level than even than Germany.
Vācijā šīs cenas pieaugums 13 gadu laikā ir bijis par 24.5%, un ir redzams, ka tās valstis, kas ir kopumā šeit paskatoties, tās valstis, kas ir ārpus Eiro zonas, tad piemēram Zviedrija, kad šis inflācija un cenu pieaugums ir mazāks nekā pat Vācijā, kur ir, kā ir, teiksim,
And you also know a little bit about doping in sports.
Sometimes sometimes for doping sporta.
Those countries, I say that Germany, Finland, France, Austria, they actually have already pushed up prices in year 97, 1998. So actually, the prices should be in the level of Denmark actually, because the year before 1999, they had, in a strange way, higher inflation just before. So maybe they try to adjust the prices just before the technical euro introduced in the economy.
Tad dažās no šīm valstīm, kuras tik nosauts, faktiski īstais cenu pieaugums pat bija pirms eiro, šī tehniskā eiro ieviešanas 99. Gadā, jo tādējādi faktiski šī cenu pieauguma šeit būtu jāparādās vēl lielākam, bet vienkārši tad būtu jāpaņem no 98. Gada, kad sākās cenu pieaugums īstenībā līdzīgi arī Igaunijā, kad liela daļa no cenu pieauguma notika jau pirms eiro ieviešanas. It's actually very similar in Estonia, it's a big part of the price increase happened before.
But here I really must also tell that the inflation in the United States almost 40% during that time, and in Canada a little bit less. But here you have the countries with problems. Ireland plus 42%, Spain plus 47%, Greece plus 53%, and also Estonia, but they had a very low price level from the start, plus 72%, and Hungary almost plus 120%.
Citās valstīs, piemēram, Amerikā šajā laika periodā ir pieaugums 39,5% cenu pieaugums, Kanādā mazāks 33%, bet tālāk ir valstis, kurās patiešām ir problēmas. Piemēram, Irijā tie ir 42%, 42,2%, Poland, Portugālē 40,5%, Spānijā 47% cenu pieaugums, Grieķijā 52%, tālāk mēs atrodam Igauniju ar 72,5% pieaugumu. Cenu pieaugums šajā 13 gadu laikā un Ungārija ar 120%.
So you can see that lots of countries in the Eurozone with the same promise, they have made the same promise into the system, but they behave like I don't see anything, I don't hear anything, I live as I did before. And in that kind of system, it's only one way, it's going to be a catastrophe.
Un faktiski visas parāda, ka valsts Eiro zonā izturās tā, ka nekas nenotika, nekā nedzirdētu, nekā nedzirdētu. Un savukārt šāda izturēšanās parāda, ka būs tikai viens iespējamais gala rezultāts, un tā būs katastrofa.
So during those circumstances, I think it's just and fair and democratic that the people of Latvia also can do as we did in Sweden, without any exceptions, put the question at least to referendum.
Un šādā situācijā, domāju, ka pilnīgi godīgi un demokrātiski cilvēki Latvijā izdarīs tāpat, kā mēs to izdarījām Zviedrijā, kad šis jautājums vismaz tiek izvērtīts uz referendumu.
And also I have to say that those figures takes long time to count because it's yearly figures. So I only have those countries, but I can also calculate the figures for Latvia if you want later.
Gribu laskiju. Tā šos cipašus sagatavot ir diezgan darbietilpīgi, ka katru gadu jākopa vairāk ilgstošu laiku periodā valsts. Bet viņš plānoja to, ka laikā mēs paprasīsim apkopot tad arī par Latviju. Vēl, teiksim, ja vajadzīs kādām valstīm, un es jau varu pateicu, ka par Latviju mēs droši vien palūksim to izdarīt. Tā prognozēja, ka mums būtu interesanti uzzināt salīdzinājumu.
And also the last thing I like to emphasize is also that one typical example of if you are in the Eurozone and have problems, you have to do like they have done in Spain. You put out people in unemployment. The level of unemployment in Spain is more than 25% now, and it is a catastrophe for the Spanish people. Young people coming out from university. More than 50% unemployed. And that is going to be a political unstable situation in all Europe if we don't do anything.
Un faktiski tālākais, teiksim, kas notiek, ir tas, ka strauji pieaug bezdarbs šajās valstīs, piemēram, Spānijā tas ir 25% jau tagad, un jaunatnes vidū pārsniedz arī 50%. Tas nozīmē, ka, ja cilvēki iznāk universitātes, viņiem faktiski nav iznākumu kādu izraču atrast šo te darbu, un tas tālāk izraisa jau liels, teiksim, liels sabiedrībā, liels spriedzi, jo no mans puses pieejamēt mūsu komentāri, ja no Latvijas, teiksim, Ja mēs vienkārši aizmukti ir kaut kas neiet īsti labi, tad tomēr no lielajām valstīm viņam jau uzkurjām, ne?
And there are also like to bring courage to my friends in Denmark to lose the peg to the euro. That's a very bad and it's not a good way to handle the economy. Don't having a floating exchange rate. And the same to Latvia. When you have your own currency for a long future, you should have it floating.
Gan Dāņu kronu, gan Latvijas ilgtermiņā būtu jādzīvo no piesaistes ar eiro, jo, ja runa tiek par ilgtermiņu, tad šī saistība ar eiro, protams, nav jāsaglabā.
And don't forget, it's not the Swedish crown now which is strong, it's the euro which is weak.
Un es gribu pateikt, ka ne jau pašlaik Zviedrijas krona ir stipra, bet eiro pašlaik ir vāja.
And of course, during the time, the highest level of the crown between two lat is now 8.7, and when it was lower, it was
5.9 cents.
The floating currency is actually not dangerous if you have good economy from the plane, because we talk about, first we talked about the Maastricht Treaty for Sweden. We had a oblige actually when we entered the European Union actually to introduce the euro in Sweden, but the politicians in Sweden said that it's a later decision, as I described. And anyway, we put out a referendum, even if we don't had any exception like they have in Denmark. And the people said no to the euro, and the politicians in Brussels said that now we have a political majority for saying no to the euro in Sweden, and we have to accept it, even if we don't, if you don't have any exceptions in the treaty. So if I can end this with saying that this money you have in your pocket is a little bit, it's a piece of freedom. Please don't give it away. Yeah.